horror, sci-fi, socially conscious themes, and swordplay flicks are all in store for you tonight. Bear has run out to the cooler and gotten me my drink of water, so we're sitting ready to go as cinematic class is about to begin. And your professor is in. Greetings, salutations, and other sundry affair. I am your cinematic professor and the purveyor of truth in movies. On tonight's show, I'd like to start you off with two really good movies that I don't think you want to miss. The first one is a really interesting horror film. It's called Alive. Folks, when I watched this movie, when it began, it had one of the grossest scenes to begin with. You know, those kind that make you sit in the chair and go, eee, because they're just so gruesome. And it kind of stayed that way all through the movie, about 90 minutes, but it had a good story, some good actors. Let me get you the names in here. There were basically only three characters in the whole movie. Angus McFadden plays the doctor. He was in the Robert the Bruce movie that I reviewed a few months ago. Camille Stops is also in this, and so is Thomas Cockerell. They all do a great job in this. It's a really good horror flick with some twists at the end that bang it up a notch, as Emerald would say. I think you're going to like this one. It's called Alive. Here's a look.
We'll be all right. We'll be okay. Do you know what happened to us?
Get away from us!
Say, the next film I want to talk to you about, I think you'll also enjoy. We go back to a little bit of sword play. The Battle for the Carpathians. The name of the movie is A Rising Hawk. You know, this movie starts with a montage. And as we all know, everybody needs a montage. Even Rocky had himself a montage in this. This is an awful lot of fun. Robert Patrick is in this. He plays the head, the elder of the village, if you will. Also in this are Tommy Flanagan, Poppy Drayden, Alex McNichol, Allison Duty. They all do a really good job on this. The movie was written by Rich Ronat and directed by John Wynn. It was actually a combination of studios for this. American and Ukraine got together and made this movie. If you enjoy movies with a whole lot of sword fighting and invasion by Mongolian armies, you're going to like this one an awful lot. I don't know if the Bidens got any kickback on this since it was from the Ukraine, but the movie is a whole lot of fun. Here's a look.
Go tell every village at the foot of these mountains.
Yeah.
The Mongols are coming.
Yeah.
It's a privilege to dying honorably. And if we are to die today, I would gladly die for you!
Yeah.
Right from the opening scene of this movie, you'll sense a bit of awkwardness. It pretty much stays through the entire film. It brags that it has Helene Udy. She is well known among horror films, especially the schlock B horror films. But even she can't salvage this movie. It's called Evil Under the Skin. And before it was released, it had a different name. It was called Fading Flowers. This title helps out the movie a bit, but it doesn't help out the movie a bit, if you know what I mean. This one is really a hot mess. There are huge gaps in the dialogue. There's a whole lot of scenery shots, and maybe that's a good thing because that helps fill it up. But once you see the awkwardness in the opening scene, you can be guaranteed that's going to continue through the rest of the movie. This movie does not know what it wants to be, whether it wants to be a thriller or whether it wants to be a horror movie. And because it can't decide, it never really does either one well. This was directed and edited by Jeff Schnorr. It's called Evil Under the Skin.
Did you happen to hear a disturbance last Thursday about 10 p.m.? Maybe you were having a party.
My daughter and I, we're eating and sleeping and sunbathing and... Is everything okay?
That's why we're here, Miss Palmer.
This is how it starts. This is how it always starts.
If anything had happened, she would have told me.
We all have secrets, Miss Palmer. Kids do things sometimes they don't want to talk about. Type of behavior we wouldn't expect.
I know what you did.
Miss Palmer, are you okay?
You know, I like Danny Trejo. He is has a nice bevy of movies under his belt, but recently he's been taking some films, I think, just for a payday, give him a little pocket change, if you will, during his semi-retirement, and this next movie certainly fits into that. Trejo is in this playing a priest. I know that's a stretch right from the get-go. And the only thing I could see in this movie that was the cause célèbre, if you will, is to try to promote female priests. Other than that, there wasn't a whole lot going on in this movie. It was really pretty bad. The title is The Last Exorcist. Folks, we can only hope.
Lord, keep me through sin throughout this day. And if I die before it's done, save me through Jesus Christ, your Son.
Bless me, Father, for I have sinned. I have had terrible thoughts about my sister. You and me?
We will get through this together.
I believe that evil has entered into her body and she's not in her right mind.
The Lord will command his angels to take good care of you.
When Father Peter died, I felt compelled to get in touch with both of you.
You stay away from me!
This next movie was made in Illinois. I just thought that was kind of fun, so I thought I'd throw it out there and mention it to you. You know, it starts out as one of those movies that the lead character, oh my God, there's no other way to say it than this girl is a bitch. I mean, wow, you just want to smack her from the opening reel. But as it turns out, you know, she learns a valuable lesson. And that lesson, boys and girls, is listen to your father. Because even though he's harsh on you now, his lessons will pay off later. And they certainly do for Mel in this movie. Mel is played by Celeste Cooper, and she does a good job on this. Also in the movie is Michael Woods and Sean Patrick Leonard, one of the dreaded three named people all through this movie. They talk about snakes and bears. There's one shot of a snake on the side of a road, doesn't play into the plot, and there's no bears. There's bears on this show. Here's a look at Range Runners.
Your body will always fight against you. That's what it was designed to do. Don't let it.
Miles I've been following you.
We've got a long way to go yet.
You don't have to prove anything to anyone, Mel.
See you in 8 days.
Next up on our docket tonight, we have another sequel. This one is called Redwood Massacre Annihilation. Now, I guess it was about 5 years ago that Redwood Massacre came out. It picked up kind of a cult following, not much else, but I gotta tell you, the killer in this is really a lot of fun. He's played by Ben Selway, and Ben does a nice job of copying, impersonating, if you will, Kane Hodder when Kane did Jason, okay, with the shoulder shrugs and whatever, to try to bring some personality to this masked killer. It's a really good masked killer. I wish the story would be a little bit better than it is. David Ryan Keith, another one of the dreaded three-name people. He wrote it, he directed it, he shot it, and he cut it up. So this is entirely his movie. He did the same thing with the first one as well. So we're being a little bit consistent in this. If you remember the first one, you remember there literally was a massacre out in the Redwood Forest. And what happens in this second one is a group of people who were chagrined that the original massacre murderer was never found have been keeping kind of like a plot in a diary, trying to solve the crime that the police and the authorities could not. And once they get a hot lead, they go out on their own. And well, guess what? The guy's still there. Yeah, and there's a nice little twist where they're caught in this facility and he's hunting them down. And so those of you who are the gore fans and like that kind of stuff, this will certainly fit into. You know, I got a problem with one thing, though. They wanted to make this an element or an issue in the woman warrior agenda. So the main character, Laura, who is played by Danielle Harris, she is a kung fu girl, okay? She's supposed to be an MMA girl. The girl can't fight. Okay, I don't know who helped her on the set, but it's painfully obvious she can't fight. And in the opening scene to set her up, they have her in her ring, and she's doing pad work. And there's a guy holding Muay Thai pads for her to let her, you know, hit off. And when the people come to talk to her, naturally they break, and the guy puts down his pads, and she's talking. And when they're done talking, and they tell her they want to go to the Redwood and try to find the real killer with this new clue, she turns around, hauls off, and sucker punches the guy that was holding the pads for her. Now, I'm sure that was put in there to try to make her look big and bad. But boys and girls, let me tell you, if you do that in a real gym or a dojo, yeah, you ain't leaving alive, brother. So, you know, you got to swallow a whole lot of crazy things for this, but the killer is what makes it all worthwhile. Here is a look at Redwood Massacre Annihilation.
So 10 years ago, my daughter Sarah went on a camping trip with her friends, and she never came home.
I'm a big fan of your work. I know you want to find him as much as I do.
What is it that you have for me that's so important?
The ending to your next best-selling book.
She'll be fine.
She's not the one I'm worried about. Seems like we're not the only ones who want to meet the boogeyman.
Okay, folks, I've given you a couple of movies that are a little bit sketchy, and you may want to avoid them. Let me give you one that I kind of liked, and I think this one will fit your bill, too. It's called Devil to Pay. Now, this one isn't quite available to you yet. It will be after October 2nd, so depending on when you see this show, may determine whether or not you can watch it or not. Danielle Deadweiler is in this, and she plays Lemon. She does a really good job. Ladies, gentlemen, if you want to have a movie with the woman warrior agenda, you know, you don't have somebody sucker punch a guy holding Muay Thai, but you do it just like they did with Lemon in this movie. This is exceptionally well done, and those of you who like and feel you need to promote the woman warrior agenda, this movie certainly will do that. You know, it's a movie all about subculture. And this subculture is for the mountain folks in the Appalachian Mountains and how they are truly removed from what's going on in society. So they band together in their own clans, and their clans have a their own system of justice. And in this particular movie, the system of justice is known as the Creed, and it has with it the Ether, which is kind of a unique concept I think you'll enjoy. And poor Lemon finds herself in the middle of a conflict over, of all things, a tree. This movie was written and directed by Ruckus and Lane Skye. They have done a really good job in putting this together, giving you a good thriller with a nice little twist along the way. I think you'll like it. It's called Devil to Pay. Here's a look.
Morning, Lemon.
Can't this wait till Toddley get home?
How long have you been gone?
Dreams can be dangerous.
Toddley?
Can blind a man to his duties.
I suppose you're wondering why I summoned you.
The debt is paid.
Say, every week I tell you about the House of Feruza, barbershop and cigar lounge. Folks, I'll tell you what, Sam is featuring some really fine bourbons in the old cigar lounge. And believe me when I tell you, they're really fine. And he's also featuring some very fine products for your face, your hair, really good stuff. And it's made locally. And that makes it even better. You want to check this out. These people really do a great job in keeping you looking your best so that you can style and profile. That's House of Feruza, Barbershop and Cigar Lounge. It's located on the corner of South Park Road and Drake Road. Ask for Sam. Tell him I sent you along. He'll take really good care of you. You know, if you're thinking on being a sponsor of the show, you should get in touch with me. It's done wonders for Sam, all during the pandemic, and even now that we're slowly coming out of it, it's still doing great things for his shop. Could do things for your business as well. Contact me either through the Facebook page, the YouTube channel, or here at the studio, and I'll be glad to sit down and talk with you. Be a sponsor of Outtakes with Fiore. You know, during this time of year, I tend to get a lot of movies that are, well, we're inching toward awards time. And even though there weren't a whole lot of movies by the big studios released, they're still planning on going through with awards. That should be kind of interesting. But when you get the award movies, a lot of them have, social justice themes going through them. Let's put it that way, okay? I think that's probably the best way to do it. And this next one is one just like that. It's called The Antenna. And folks, this comes to us from Turkey. Now, I don't know if you've been following the political ramifications of what's going on over in Turkey, but it is certainly reflected in this movie. It's presented to us from Dark Star Studios. There's an awful lot of overhead shots in this. I think it's because drones are more popular now, and they actually look pretty good. You know, the characters are kind of interesting in this, and the whole story basically boils down to the attempt by the government to make everyone the same, to make sure that everyone is thinking the same way, acting the same way, and speaking the same way. And if you, by any chance, you know, have a thought that goes away from the government thought, you need to be eliminated, okay? It's getting like that, okay? Now, you can draw whatever analogies you want to today's political climate, but let me tell you that the way they do this is through, they're going to be your friend. See, they're doing this all for you. And they're setting up this system which basically controls all that you see and hear. Now, you know, you can interpret this movie on several different ways, but probably the most prominent is the coming of the 5G. I'm not sure if you've been staying on top of what this 5G thing is being touted as the best. This is going to be great. There's going to be little towers on every other corner that will control everything. But there's also some research that says this stuff can kill you too. So, you know, it's a pump your brakes, son, before you get into this. And a movie like The Antenna tells you what could happen if we go through with it. Here's a look.
Yeni sistemi kuracaklarmış. Görevli biri geldi. Çatının anahtarını verdim, yukarı çıktı.
Sat back and thought to yourself, or even possibly opined to your friends, what superpower you would like to have if you were allowed to have one? Well, I'm sure the answers vary. They usually do. But a lot of times you just don't sit back and think about what are the ramifications if I actually have that power. And that is the basis for our next movie, Immortal. These folks can't die. They are immortal. And while they may have sat back and said, gee, I wish I could live forever, I don't think they thought this all the way through. And there are four little stories contained in this movie. So it is an anthology that explains the other side of being immortal, possibly the side you hadn't considered before you asked for the superpower. This is, you know, let me just say two words to you. Jump cuts, all right? Those of you that have been following my reviews and my show know that as soon as I see jump cuts, there a lot of times I'll just shut the movie off and say, that's it, I'm done with it. Yeah. I didn't on this one. I stayed with it, and I'm glad I did, because the movie was actually an awful lot of fun. I enjoyed all four of the tales, and it had some pretty decent star power in this. Tony Todd shows up in one of the stories, and so does Mario Van Peebles. He shows up in one of them. Agnes Bruckner, who is another name among horror fans, she shows up in one of these movies. So there was a cast there. Dylan Baker is also in this. You'll recognize him as soon as you see him. He plays the teacher in the first story. And there, I stuck through it through the jump cuts just so I can see how these guys did. I'm kind of glad I did. If you can get by the jump cuts, I think you'll be okay with this. It was written by John DeBash, and he had a little help from Dan Isaacs on this. And together, they put together a nice collection, four stories long, of the not only great power of immortality, but the flip side of it as well.
Imagine what it would be like if you can't die.
Pain is a strange thing. It's there in your body as an alarm system to tell you if there's something wrong.
And when you don't eat or sleep, your days get pretty long.
You just can't get your food.
Try to pretend the camera's not even here. Tell me what was going through your mind the first time you heard the diagnosis.
Well, I went through all the different stages of grief. That sense of normalcy that you once shared, it sacrificed really quickly.
Why is it that we paint good guys in such infuriating clothing?
Every hero with a conscience has some debilitating physical deformity or a self-confidence problem, while the evil, satanic torturers of the literary world get to wear capes of leather and drive great cars. What do you think it says about us as a society that the bad guys are always more fun?
Well, Bear has joined me on the set, which means we're just about out of time and we need to wrap things up. You know, we're going to have to find a name for Bear. We can't just keep calling him Bear, right? Maybe we'll run a contest or something. Tune into the next show and we'll find out. Maybe we can find a name for him by the time we do show 600. Would you like that? Yeah, I thought you might. Okay. Before we skedaddle out of here, I want to tell you about another movie that deals with social justice. That's the big theme going into the awards ceremony. This one is called Wall of Mexico, and it stars Issei Morales, who is a fine actor. Now, folks, depending when you're watching this show, it's not going to be available to you till the middle of October, but I wanted to give you a heads up on it now. It is so symbolic and an allegory. Remember a few years back, Gareth Edwards took the concept of illegal immigrants trying to cross from Mexico over to America and their trials and tribulations, and he reversed it. He had a group of Americans who were trapped in Mexico trying to get over the wall and get back home. There was one problem. There was a whole horde of alien monsters who were preventing them from getting there. You remember that? It was called Monsters. It was a really good movie, and it brought Edwards up to at least enough notoriety that they gave him Godzilla after that. So, certainly that worked out well for him. Similar situation happens here, but it's not sci-fi, and we don't have alien monsters, you know, patrolling the Mexican border. It all has to do with the illusion of a finer life and entitlement. You know, I've got an awful lot to say about this, but since we are running out of time, I want you to go ahead and shoot on over to the Outtakes with Fiore blog spot. We'll put that URL down here for you, and you could shoot over there and read my most ponderous prose on all of the allegories and political ramifications of the Wall of Mexico. In the meantime, here's a look.
Hey, you've known those girls since they were little kids.
Sorry to say.
I'm not neurotic per se. I'd say that you're more neurotic.
So do you want to come to the playhouse or not?
Say something hilarious.
What do you say?
How long you lived here?
About a month.
Work for the Mexicans, right?
Everyone. The well's at 30%.
We just want to know if anyone has seen anything.
What's the deal with the water?
They sell it. It has a flavor too. Unusual.
People in town are freaks about it. This job sucks.
You asked for it.
That's going to do it for us tonight. You have yourself a bevy of movies to select from when it comes to spending your hard-earned entertainment dollar, and I'm working on a bunch more for the next episode. But now that you have learned what you have learned, class is dismissed.